Sandra Steingraber, she's been called one of the 25 visionaries who are changing your world. Part one of our two-part interview, next on Enviro Close-Up. Welcome to Enviro Close-Up. I'm Carl Grossman. Sandra Steingraber has been called the new Rachel Carson by the Sierra Club. She's been named Woman of the Year by Ms. Magazine and one of the 25 visionaries who are changing your world by Utne Reader. She's the recipient of the Rachel Carson Leadership Award and the Jennifer Altman Foundation's Altman Award for inspiring and poetic use of science to elucidate the causes of cancer. Great to be speaking with you, Sandra.
Thanks for having me, Carl. It's great to be here.
Sandra, your inspiration has been Rachel Carson. Could you please explain why?
Sure. So Rachel Carson is kind of my guiding spirit in all the work I do. She, of course, came of age in a different generation than did I. But she is both a biologist who made her living as a writer, which is how I have organized my own life. And her book, Silent Spring, came out when I was only 3 years old. But I feel as if I am one of the youngest people to remember the publication of that book, because my dad used it as a course text in his consumer education class as a young biology professor at the time. So I realized that it was one of these books that I think I, like a lot of people, think they've read because it's so iconic. But in fact, no professor had ever assigned me to actually read it. And when I did, it was really with a writer's eye. And I wanted now to do what she had done, and which is to say, to find a language beautiful enough to honor the biological systems that she and I were both writing about, and use language as a vehicle to help people look at some really difficult truths about the chemical contamination of our environment. Now, you know, 30 years of feminism lie between my adult life and hers, and so in some ways my tasks were so much easier than her own. She received all kinds of attacks by industry, as have I, but very ad hominem attacks. You know, she was criticized for being a spinster, and like, why would she care about future generations if she didn't have children of her own and that sort of thing. And because of that, she scrupulously kept her own autobiography out of her writing. In fact, she hid huge parts of herself, most notably the fact that she herself was a cancer patient while writing Silent Spring. And her writings to her dear friend, Dorothy, was where she revealed her fears around that. But she was sure, and I think she was right about this, that if she had revealed that she herself had cancer, her chapter on the evidence linking pesticide exposure to cancer would have been called, her objectivity as a scientist would have been called into question. So I made a different decision with my own writing, thinking about, like, reading her private writings and then reading her public writings and seeing this huge disconnect. I felt like the challenge before me was, what if I could bring these things together and write about my life as a cancer patient, which of course is the other thing I have in common with Carson, and write about that autobiographically in the same book where I'm dispassionately and objectively laying out the evidence for a link between cancer and the environment. And it was my feeling that a window had opened up in the culture that allowed me to do that. And it was particularly because feminism had opened that pathway to me. The idea that women's experience is not only interesting, but also authoritative. And on top of that, the things that happen to us are not necessarily the opposite of being able to correctly analyze a bunch of data, that I could do both of those things. And in so doing, I would create a narrative strategy that allowed me to reveal the lives behind the data points, using my own life as simply one. So here's a bunch of data from my home county showing that we have an excess rate of cancer there, significantly statistically higher than other zip codes. And then I could go into the toxics release inventory databases, along with filing Freedom of Information Act requests to get access to where drinking water wells had been contaminated and where the toxic sites were, and begin to build a bridge between two big bunches of data, which are collected by different parts of our state government. The cancer registry data on the one hand, which shows temporal and geographic patterns, a sort of moving shadow of cancer across the geographic landscape, clearly demonstrating that cancer is not a random tragedy, but shows patterns in time and space, and take that bunch of data together with what we know about where we've dumped the toxic waste, where we're spraying pesticides, where the drinking water wells are contaminated, and bring those two things together. And in so doing, you know, I reveal myself as one data point in that cluster of cancers, because ultimately this is a human rights issue, especially for those of us who have cancers caused by someone else's decision to use a cancer-causing agent and release it into the common environment that we all share, particularly when we are children, that we know that raises risk for harm. And so I'm still paying the price for my own health based on decisions that were made about industrial practices and agricultural practices years before I was born. Practices that were careless and based on ignorance at first, and then even when we had evidence for harm, those practices continued just because it's the way that we did things. It was familiar. And Carson actually called this the harmless aspect of the familiar. And so that is a phrase I took up and really wanted to explore. But I felt like I was going to be able to actually talk about myself in and around the data, and I could dare myself into that in a way that wasn't going to be available to Carson at all. And I think I was right about that, because I, of course, you know, my work is heavily scrutinized by industry, and they've had their things to say about it. And of course, there's still ad hominem attacks, you know, so they can write book reviews and say that I'm a woman with cancer who feels particularly emotional about that experience without ever having mentioned I have a Ph.D. in science. But for the most part, you know, I'm able to redirect our attention to what that data actually show. And I think, so I'm inspired by Carson, but I'm also internally grateful to a lot of women who opened that space up in the years between 1962 and then 1997, when the first edition of that book was published. And then I had another opportunity then when a filmmaker came along in 2010 and decided to adapt that book for film. And that gave me a chance to rewrite the book. The science had evolved, and so of course the second edition of Living Downstream is much longer than the first, because there's so much more science now, including this whole new field of epigenetics, which specifically looks at the way in which certain hormonally active agents can insinuate themselves into the cellular machinery and turn on and turn off genetic switches, not causing mutations, which is the sort of classic pathway to cancer formation, but rather changing what we call gene expression. So even in 1997, we didn't know much about that, but by the time I rewrote the book in 2010, there was a whole burgeoning field of study. So I had a lot of rewriting to do so that the film version and the book version could be equally current. But at the same time, what was interesting to me was the autobiographical piece really changed for me, because in the 4 years that we filmed together, the camera's eye saw things about me that I didn't know or couldn't see myself. And so I ended up almost adapting those sections based on the film. So the film and the book really exist in a kind of reciprocity, right? And just to give an example, in a book, of course, an author can take a reader back in time, which you can't really do in a documentary film. So I could take you back to the moment of my own cancer diagnosis at age 20. And because we couldn't replicate that in a documentary film, what the surrogate, the sort of proxy for that scene was taking a film crew into one of my own cystoscopic checkups and film me with my feet in the stirrups and the inside of my body on the big screen television and everyone looking for signs of tumor and discussing it and me lying there. So I go through these exams every couple of months. Sometimes I get to go 6 months to a year, but I have another one scheduled actually. So I'm sitting here talking to you in a couple more weeks. I'll have, another one. I just had one. Now there's more ambiguity. Now we have to look again. So I lead this kind of highly medicalized life. And although I wrote about that experience in the book, because it's a very internalized experience with a lot of sort of anxiety and dread, it's not as though I have a kind of bird's eye view of what a cystoscope is actually like. So all that's to say is that the experience of working with the filmmaker, which I'm doing again now, really actually has changed my process as a science writer.
We're with Sandra Steingraber, a writer par excellence, environmental writer, and an activist. Your dad was a professor like yourself, and Rachel Carson's Silent Spring, first published in 1962, was a landmark in ecological environmental writing. I used that book too as a professor in my environmental journalism class. Now, you went on after Living Downstream to write Having Faith, an Ecologist's Journey to Motherhood, which was the next step in your life, motherhood. Would you discuss that book, please?
Sure. So I became a mother at the brink of 40, having had cancer at the brink of 20, which I know isn't how most people's lives are organized, but that's how mine worked out. And so for me, pregnancy was a kind of miraculous experience. And I really did lie down on the same ultrasound table in Boston's Beth Israel Hospital to receive my first prenatal ultrasound that I had formerly been signed for scans of looking for signs of tumor. The idea that my body could grow this beautiful new life was, it was utterly remarkable to me. I mean, as a mammal, as a woman, as a biologist, I was just fascinated by the whole phenomenon. So I really kind of turned my scientist eye inward at that point because I was aware that some of the chemicals I had been writing about and their ability to influence the story of human cancer also played a role in altering pathways of development. So I got very interested in the field of fetal toxicology and moved actually at that point from Boston to Cornell University and took up a post in the environmental health program at Cornell, which gave me access to the library resources and things that I needed to understand, because I really had to teach myself embryology and the development of the placenta and things like that. So it was the science in that book is some pretty tough sledding, really complicated neuroendocrinology and things like that. But the writing piece of it was a dream because a pregnancy kind of organizes itself, right? So I could just tell the story chronologically in diaristic fashion. Each chapter is 1 month of pregnancy, then comes the kind of climax of the birth scene, and then the kind of denouement of breastfeeding relationship, which goes on for a couple more chapters. So the arc in that book is really the moment of conception through the time where the breastfeeding relationship begins to come to an end, which for my daughter was right around the age of 3. And the book is called Having Faith, my daughter's name being Faith, and so I guess our listeners and viewers can imagine why a woman with cancer would name a child Faith. So the sort of literary part of that book was really easy. The science was very difficult, which was a little bit different from Living Downstream, which was heavier on the science, but it was more complicated to me to write about my life as a cancer patient. I found that more challenging.
And your third book was Raising Elijah, Protecting Our Children in an Age of Environmental Crises. Describe the nature of that book, please.
Right. So Raising Elijah, named after my other child, my son Elijah, who came next. And the science in that book really continues from where Having Faith left off. So it starts with birth and then takes a look at the way different kinds of inherently toxic chemicals enter the story of child development and can alter different organ systems in ways that make this new person turn out differently than they otherwise would. And that book goes from takes place after birth and goes up through and including the timing and tempo of puberty. And that book, because it covers a much longer span of time, represented a bigger writing challenge to me. And it's the only book I've ever written in the past tense, because the past tense is a bit roomier than diaristic present tense. And so I could do flashbacks and kind of skip over long chunks of time. But it's really the story that and the characters that hopefully the reader comes to care about that's going to carry you through some pretty complicated pharmacokinetics or neurology of the fetal brain and things like that. So if I do my job right, I create a dramatic story, and in order to understand why the story turns out the way it does, you know, why do so many of the children in Elijah's class have autism? You have to understand something about fetal brain development and the way in which brain cells migrate down neurons. And I'm going to describe all that to you. So that's kind of how I work.
When you think of your work, Sandra, and your activities, how do you see the future? How do you think we can avoid a silent spring?
Well, things are actually much more dire than when Carson wrote, although I strike a slightly different tone than she does about all this. And so I remain hopeful and optimistic, and I feel as though I don't have a choice about that. I mean, climate change now has been layered over top of chemical pollution, which is essentially what Carson was writing about. So we really have two twin crises going on now. And one of them, namely climate change, has a really tight deadline attached to it. So the tragedy of chemical pollution, which, you know, kills people by seeding cancers into their bodies, which alters pathways of development such that children have lowered IQs than they otherwise would, shorter attention spans, girls enter puberty sooner than they otherwise would, which sets them up for higher risk of breast cancer, for higher rates of sexual victimization, and there are secondary consequences to these things. So that's all a horrible tragedy. But the truth of that story is that we could go on poisoning ourselves forever until we finally figure out a way to abolish chemical carcinogens and embrace green chemistry, which is being held hostage by the chemical industry. Not so with climate change. With climate change, we hit what we in the scientific community would call tipping points, meaning that if we go on loading up the atmosphere with heat-trapping gases, at some point, no matter what we do to embrace green energy, which of course is the analog to green chemistry and in the energy world, meaning wind, water, and solar, it won't matter anymore because we will have triggered these positive feedback loops that no matter what we do, no matter if we stop burning fossils altogether, we're now on this runaway train. And the best science suggests we have about 2 decades before we hit that. It could come sooner, and we may have already hit it, but certainly we could make things a lot worse if we continue to go in this direction. So of these two crises, one has a deadline attached to it. The other one really doesn't, although it's a profound human rights crisis, right? So what I begin to lay out at the end of Raising Elijah, my most recent book, which is becoming the starting point now for my current book project, is the idea that these twin environmental crises, the chemical pollution crisis on the one hand and the climate crisis on the other, they're like rivers that have a confluence, there or a tree that has two trunks and share a common root. And the common root behind both of these crises is this ruinous dependency on fossil fuels, which if you shovel them into ovens and light them on fire, you load up the atmosphere with heat-trapping gases and threaten to bring down the whole climate system. and everything living, of course, depends on a stable climate. But we don't just burn them. We could also take these unholy trinity, coal, oil, and gas, into our petrochemical factories, and then we make stuff out of it. And hydrous ammonia is synthetic fertilizer, wholly made out of natural gas, which is methane. And a lot of pesticides originally came from coal tar, now come from a barrel of oil. In fact, a lot of the chemicals, including plastic bags, that we don't really need but keep being generated because they actually solve a waste disposal problem for the energy industry, right? So just to give an example, when we blast methane out of the bedrock, we get more than just, and methane is what natural gas is, we get more than just methane, which is one carbon with four hydrogens. We also get these other lightweight molecules, including ethane. Okay, now ethane we can't just light on fire and burn. So that we put in a pipeline, send it down to Louisiana, and turn it into plastic bags. We solve a waste disposal problem for the energy industry, thus giving us more disposable plastic, which nobody needs. All of it ends up in the ocean. So now we have microparticles of plastic in the ocean that, in many places of the Pacific, outweigh the plankton by a factor of six. Those are consumed by the fish that we eat, and then the ethane then becomes this chemical pollution problem, right? So these things are related. That's the point. And so by seeing these two crises as related, as sharing a root, actually gives us a way to go after. In other words, we can kill two birds with one stone if we got off fossil fuels. And that's why I feel hopeful and optimistic, because even though the problem is overwhelmingly huge and our entire economy floats on oil and floats on gas, if we could immediately move off of that and do something different and basically free up green chemistry on the one hand and green energy on the other, and bring those into center stage and make those the normative way we do stuff, then we solve everything. And that is where the hope lies, I think, because it's not like we have 10,000 problems. We have one problem, and the problem is fossils. And the consequences are manifold. We have plankton stocks that are in trouble because the oceans are warming and because the CO2 that's pumped into the atmosphere is actually absorbed by the ocean water. It's turned into carbonic acid, making the oceans 30% more acid than they had been prior to the Industrial Revolution. We're now putting on all organisms that are made of shells, which is what calcium carbonate is. Those guys are all on track to dissolve, because at some point you hit the pH point where everything that's made of calcium carbonate simply dissolves into solution. And so you might think, well, I just won't eat oysters anymore. But in fact, almost all of the zooplankton represent the larval form of stuff that when they're adults have shells, like barnacles and coral reefs and things like that. And so that's the basis of the entire oceanic food system. And so we ecologists are paying a lot of attention to that. The problem is that nobody's given the memo to the rest of the world. And so that's where I have sort of declared my work lies, in that place of translating this complicated science in a language that not only people, that's plain spoken enough that not only people can understand, but also to find a narrative to talk about that that doesn't lead people to a place of just absolute abject despair. And so I began with Raising Elijah, and this is where I want to continue, thinking about what leads people to action, because action, of course, is the antidote to despair. And that requires believing that our current situation is so unnecessary and so stupid, and that there are these elegant, innovative, beautiful alternative ways that we should really be embracing, and urge people to become advocates for that other way of doing things. And so I'm really interested, and there are multiple narrative strategies one could choose. So I'm really interested, you know, in figuring out how to do that for people. And my sense, I have sort of two intuitions about this. One is that I don't want to tell people what to do, because I think that even though people claim, oh, just tell me what I should do, that's, even though that's what they ask, that's not what they really want. In fact, oftentimes people ask you, well, just, you know, what should I do? So rather, I kind of take a lesson from my reading of Martin Luther King Jr., who argued that his purpose was not to solve any crises for people or tell them what to do, but to create a crisis and to make people look into the mirror and ask themselves, what am I ethically responsible for right now? You know, how do I want to get myself out of this moral dilemma? And then the other piece of it is that I don't want to ever downplay the magnitude of the crisis. So that's this kind of narrative dilemma a lot of environmental writers feel themselves in. Like, if we really tell the truth about how serious the problem is, then people will really fall into despair. And so therefore, let's not tell the whole story. Let's just tell a little bit of the story and then encourage people to start small and, like, recycle or something like that. But I think that people know now that dutifully carrying their recyclables out to the curb is not going to keep the ice caps frozen and isn't going to keep the Gulf Stream from collapsing. And so why not just really lay it out, but then point out to people that the way to solve a problem when the magnitude of the problem is huge is to match the size of your actions to the size of the problem, which means we all need to become heroes at this particular moment in history. And there are other times in history where people had to do heroic things, like go off and defeat global fascism and take on Hitler, or abolish slavery and divorce our economy from a ruinous dependence on unpaid slave labor. These were huge problems that people had to come to terms with and really had to look in the mirror and decide what side they were on. And so I'm really interested in trying to engage people that way and look back in history to see how people in the Warsaw Ghetto decided against all odds they were going to stand up anyway, or how people who hid runaway slaves, knowing that they had, you know, six kids and a crop in the field, and if they went to jail, nobody was coming to take care of their family. Why did they do that anyway at such great risk to themselves? And that's why that last book is named Raising Elijah. My son Elijah is actually named after an abolitionist from my home state of Illinois, Elijah Lovejoy, who was actually assassinated by a pro-slavery mob and pumped full of five bullets on his 35th birthday. But his words as an abolitionist writer lived on after him. So the title is intended to be kind of a double entendre, right? How can we raise up the spirit of Elijah Lovejoy for our times? How can we bring back an abolitionist spirit where we're not just, you know, we decided at some point in our nation's history we're not going to just regulate slavery. We're not going to improve slavery emission rates. You know, we're just going to abolish it because, as Elijah Lovejoy said, it's just a homicidal abomination and we need immediate emancipation. That's what he insisted on. So how can we do that now?
There's so much, much more for us to talk about, especially how you've combined your research and writings with direct action, challenging the entities that have made and are making a mess of the planet, and even going to jail in doing so. We'll discuss this and more in part two of our two-part Enviro close-up interview with Sandra Steingraber. Thank you for being with us, Sandra.
It's nice to be here. Thanks for having me, Carl.
Go to our website, EnviroVideo.com, and follow us on Twitter at EnviroVideo. For Enviro Close Up, I'm Carl Grossman. Thanks for watching.